Howdy, folks. Welcome to Water by the Quarter, a show that focuses on the most important resource we have, water. My name's Jim Nash. I'm the Oakland County Water Resources Commissioner. Welcome. Today, I'm honored to have our special guest, Oakland County Executive Dave Coulter. He's the third county executive Oakland County has had, and the first member that came, the first executive that came from the Board of Commissioners originally. He's also the former mayor of Ferndale. And I have to say, I've known Dave for a long time, over 15 years, since I first started in politics. I came into office as a county commissioner from Farmington Hills, and Dave was already there. He was our caucus leader my first term, a couple of terms. And so we've worked together on a bunch of things around the environment, and we've had good luck passing things, and the county's come a long way since then. I'm here to welcome. Good to have you, Dave.
Well, Jim, it's great to be here. And I might just add, the county's come a long way because of the role that you've played in your new position after being on a county commission. So I'm really proud of all that you've done to help lead Oakland County on the environmental front, and proud to be a friend.
Well, I appreciate that a lot, man. It's been good to work for you for a long time, and I look forward to working here quite a lot longer too. So, since you've come on board as a county executive, you've made a lot of changes around the county. One of the things that we started last fall, my office and I have been working with your staff on creating an environmental sustainability and renewable energy kind of leadership effort that we're doing at the county. You want to kind of go over what you call this and what we're trying to do here?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. And it's a little surprising that we didn't really have one before. You know, for a lot of us, at least you and I, Jim, and a lot of people in this space, we've known for a while that sustainability is critical to not only our county's future, but our planet's future. And so that just means that you and I have the opportunity to do this. And I'll just share the story that, you know, the very first meeting I had with Jim, after I became county executive, Jim laid out this amazing vision about, you know, solar panels on the roofs of all of our county buildings and a green campus and sustainable infrastructure. And I was struck and excited by Jim's vision, and I'm happy to work with you, Jim, on this. So as you said, we've been working together on a plan. And I should also say, with our Board of Commissioners, who would have to approve and supply the funds for any plans. But we've been working on this over the past year and a half, kind of on a dual track, I would say. So let me just say, we're looking at it from the perspective of our own campus in Oakland County, which is actually pretty large. We have a pretty large footprint as a county government. And then on a parallel track, the county as a whole. Both of these tracks, however, with the ultimate goal of achieving net zero emissions by 2030. That's the goal that we're going to put, that we put out there, and that we're going to try to achieve. So, like I said, first of all, on our campus itself, we own a lot of buildings. We use fuel. We use energy. We have a fleet of vehicles, et cetera. So what are the things that we can do right away as a county so that, A, we can reduce our own footprint on our campus, but also to demonstrate to other communities across the county best practices and things that they can do? I don't think we can go out and tell other communities to be more environmentally friendly if the county isn't backing up its action, its words with action. So we'll be a model of best practices for the county. But then secondly, among the county, we're going to work on creating a countywide climate action plan. I don't know what the plan will be called yet, but if any of your viewers have a great snazzy name, we'd probably be open to that. But I believe that as a region that we can do this. And I will say that one of the ways that I think we can do this is to help incentivize them. A lot of times, our local communities want to do more, but they simply can't for resource reasons. And I think there's a role in there for the county to play.
Absolutely. For me, water in the water sector, the biggest impact in the Great Lakes region from climate change is going to be extreme weather and large storms like we had about 7 years ago, where we have significant amounts of rain that are falling that are just swamp our system. So the more we can do to mitigate that change in weather, the better we are as a world. But we can be that leader in Michigan, and I think we can develop the best practices that we can really be an example for the whole state. So I really appreciate you doing that. Yeah. Among these are going to be economic impacts. What do you see in terms of that? As my example, I put solar panels on my house about 4 years ago, and this is saving me a tremendous amount of money over time. Those kind of savings, those kind of efficiencies can bring a lot. How do you see that happening?
Well, you hit it on the head. there is sort of an upfront cost, additional cost to these kinds of investments, these kinds of renewable energy or climate change kinds of investments. But just like with the example of your solar panels, there is a quantifiable return on investment that you will get. So if you're willing to spend a little now, you can save a whole lot more later, because I do think there's a huge economic benefit to this. And by the way, Jim, you mentioned the floods of 2014, which I was the mayor of Ferndale then while you were the water resource commissioner. I can tell you the cost of that flood to Ferndale was very, very high. And so, not having spent money to mitigate those sort of effects ended up costing us dramatically. And that's going to continue to happen going forward. So I would say we can't afford not to do these things. But I would also say, like President Biden has said, that even though there is an upfront cost to some of these, to converting to renewable energies, there's a huge opportunity in terms of the jobs that will get created, for instance, and the savings to residents and businesses when they make these investments. So it's not a matter of if we should make these investments, but how we can incentivize these investments. So I'll tell you, one of the things that we did in Ferndale is we created a revolving loan fund. And what we put up an initial amount of money up front and said, yes, we know that these projects have an additional cost up front and we'll help you pay for those. But we also know, as I said, that there is a quantifiable return on your investment. We know that you will save money over the life of your project. So let's take that amount. And then a portion of those savings goes back into this revolving fund that we created so that we can seed other projects and do it. So it can be a self-perpetuating kind of fund. So we just have to get creative about this. But the biggest thing, and you hit it on the head, Jim, is to get past this notion that we can do nothing and it'll be okay. If we do nothing, we will continue to have worse and worse climate incidents like we had with the flood. And we will eventually pay for this one way or the other. So let's get creative. Let's all just agree that this is a priority and that an investment today will mean long-term benefits for all of us tomorrow.
Absolutely. So, I mean, you see, as this effort, as we're trying to address our own energy issues, our own transportation, all those things as a county, how do you see you being able to work with local businesses, individuals, homeowners, those kind of things? How do you see that working out and going forward?
Yeah, I think a couple of things. First of all is, Jim, what you do every day and what we're doing on this show, which is education. We have a bully pulpit or a platform as government leaders, especially in a unit of government like Oakland County, which is, it's respected, it's fiscally responsible, and we're a very large county. And so we have a pulpit to help educate people. And this show and the programs that you run and all of the activities that you do, Jim, in your role, I think are very important, and we can't minimize those. I think that communication and education is critical to building a mass of people who understand the value of doing this. So we can do that, and we should do that, and we can be a leader in Oakland County, not just from the Water Resources Commissioner's Department, but from the Executive's Department and throughout county government. So that's number two. I mean, that's number one. But number two is to do things like I had sort of referenced that we did in Ferndale. And I think we can bring that program to the county, that revolving loan fund to the county. Last year in my state of the county, I asked the Board of Commissioners to set money aside for that kind of a revolving loan fund. And that money is now sitting there waiting for us to sort of finalize this climate action plan. But once we do that, my goal with that would be that no community in Oakland County has finances as their excuse not to do more. Because frankly, in Ferndale, that was kind of our excuse. We'd love to do more of this, but you know, unless the money comes from the feds or the state, where do we squeeze the money out of our already tight budgets to invest in this? And so I think that Oakland County is in the position financially to be able to make those kinds of investments. So we wouldn't force communities to do this, but I wouldn't want a community to use finances as an excuse not to do what we all know is the right thing. So if we create a fund like that and we offer that to the locals, I think there's a whole lot of them that'll take us up on it. And by the way, let's not forget, there's a lot of communities in Oakland County that are already rolling up their sleeves and doing great work. Not only Ferndale, but Royal Oak and a couple of other communities have sustainability planners on their planning teams now. They're already beginning to look at how do we incorporate lead or just green technologies into our building codes and into the projects that we do. I think that is so smart. So I think there's a real appetite on the part of a lot of our communities to do this. And they just kind of need that incentive from us. And I think that with yours and my leadership in that, we can incentivize them to do that.
Absolutely. No, we have a very willing audience in terms of local governments. And also the business community is really kind of accepting sustainability as a project now. And there's a Detroit Regional Sustainability Business Partnership that I've been in some meetings with. There's a lot of understanding that the upfront investments will have a payback that will be dwarf them over time. So again, when you're talking about a system where you're putting out some money, people invest, and then they can pay back the loan just with the savings from their energy, and at least balance out or still stay ahead. So the investments are important, and it can build a lot of local businesses, because as you use distributed energy, local businesses will be the ones to go to homes and businesses and do repairs, increase the output, things like that, rather than when it's in a single power plant. The company that runs a power plant has the people do that work every day. Instead, you'll be out in all these communities doing this work as small businesses. So it'll be a big driver of small business in the communities that accept this as something they want to do.
Yeah.
So I really think the payback is just broad in a whole bunch of different ways. And, you know, again, that's how I appreciate what you guys are doing so much. So how do you see this affecting the quality of life for just average people? Where do you see this impacting them?
Yeah. Well, building off of what you just said is job creation. So, you know, I'm a free market guy at heart. I'm not, when I talk about, you know, government sort of seeding this and leveraging our ability to promote this, it's not us doing this, right? You're going to create, and there's not create because it's there, but you're going to help expand a whole segment of commerce around providing these kinds of services. And so what that's going to do is it's going to create jobs and it's going to create businesses, because there is a quantifiable return on investment that you will make when you get into this line of work. And so job creation and therefore tax revenue and the like that helps pay for our jobs will come along with this, right? We will, you know, we can see this, but I believe that the free market, given the guidelines and the directives of folks like us, will just take off maybe in ways that we can't even envision today, because we're a very creative and entrepreneurial people, and there will be jobs and businesses created as a result of this. So I would say that maybe the most important, and I don't want to lose sight of the fact that protecting our health, the health of our residents and the health of our planet is paramount. You know, we're at a moment in time where we can't afford to wait on this any longer. And if we want a good quality of life for our children and our grandchildren, we need to do this now. And I think that's a direct benefit of this as well. And then the final thing that I would mention is just, you know, one of the reasons, or, you know, that a lot of us are here in Oakland County is it's a beautiful county in terms of our natural resources. We have lakes and rivers and wetlands and trails and wildlife. And we have a high quality of life here, and we need to protect those assets. And those assets are inextricably linked to this greater challenge that you and I have been talking about, which is the impact of climate and the change that that's having on our natural resources and our natural assets here in the county. So if we want to protect our quality of life in terms of our environment, if we want to protect our health and create jobs and businesses in this county, we can do all of those things. There's really no downside to going down this path other than an upfront cost. But, you know, I think that because of the financial strength of Oakland County, we can mitigate that and we can manage that. And so to me, there are only pros and very, very few cons. And the greatest pro of all, of course, is to protect Mother Earth and make sure that we're leaving our grandchildren something to be proud of.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you're kind of talking about a cultural shift that we're seeing an appreciation of our resources as necessary to our health and our economic well-being. And that's really, you know, super important in terms of how we develop these sustainability, programs and policies. How do you see that? Again, young folks, yeah, high school through, you know, early 30s, that I deal with a lot, because I do a lot of outreach to high schools, to colleges, and my, you know, a lot of the younger engineers are animated by this, and they really, really are working to, because they see it in their own lives. People younger than us have seen the weather change. I mean, last year, in the middle, January 15th of last year, we had a 3-inch rainstorm come through this area. When we were kids, was anything like that ever existed? You know, I mean, that wasn't how weather was when we were young. And they recognize that, too. How do you see that? Will this play that kind of cultural shift that we're looking to help?
Well, you know, that's spot on, Jim. It's not, like you said, it's not the 30-year-olds that we have to convince. It's more the people in our own age group, to be honest with you, because we grew up with a certain cavalier attitude about the environment. Now, you know, our generation did get serious about, you know, air quality and cleaning our rivers, which were on fire at the time. So, you know, we did what we thought was right then. But these younger people understand today better than the people of our own generation. And that's why your efforts as the Water Resource Commissioner over the last many years has been so important, because Oakland County as a county needs to lead by example. We need to step up, and it needs to be more than just you, Jim. It needs to be me and all the countywides. It needs to be the governor. It needs to be the president. We need to lead by example. And because local communities can't do it by themselves. I remember when I was mayor of Ferndale, that's when Donald Trump had taken over the presidency and decided to pull America out of the Paris Accord, the global climate change accord. And I was devastated by that. And I'm glad that President Biden is bringing us back into the Paris Accord, frankly. But here's what we did. A lot of mayors got together and said, well, maybe if enough of us got together and committed our own local communities to the goals and guidelines of the Paris Accords, that we could maybe mitigate the effects of what the president has done. And so I signed on. I was a climate change mayor. A number of mayors did that. But that is not the best way to solve global and national issues on a patchwork like that. It was our attempt to try to mitigate the effects of that. But a better approach is to have the entire nation, the entire state on board. And that's why I think it's important that Oakland, in our region that we have some responsibility for, that we lead by example and lead all the communities in our county on this path. And we can do that by our example. We can do that by our incentives and the tool, and giving local communities the tools that they need to get this work done. And we don't have to convince the young people, but we need to make it crystal clear to everybody else that there's no retreat from this battle of climate change. This is a battle that we have to win and we have to be serious about. And we will do that by example, by rolling up our sleeves and getting it done.
No, that's great. And, you know, by being a leader in that, we can help when hopefully further help comes, we can be that example of how we can get this done quickly. You know, it brings us to how do you see the best ability for the state and federal governments to help us do this? What do you think that they can do that would really help us get these kind of things done?
Well, I have some ideas, but, you know, Jim, you're often the guy I turn to for thoughts and best practices as well. So I'm going to ask you to answer your own question as well. I will just tell you that we do, I understand the importance of having national leadership on an issue like global warming and just like a global pandemic, right? We can't all be in this for ourselves. The county of Oakland or the state of Michigan can't be committed to climate change if the rest of the country is not. So you do need national leadership. And when we had that national leadership, we saw programs that incentivized solar power and wind power and wind turbines. You know, we have a lot of wind turbines across the state, and that happened not because the market was there yet, but because there were state and federal incentives to do that until the market caught up with that. And so we're going to need those kind of incentives again. It will require a national and a state commitment. So we are going to have to work in lockstep with our state and federal representatives. We're going to have to push them where we need to push them and get them to provide the kinds of incentives and policies that will protect our environment. But I'm going to be looking to you, my friend, because you've been in this space for decades. You've been a leader in this for decades. And now that we have a president that's listening and a governor that's listening and you have a county executive that's listening, we will continue to take your advice and your counsel in terms of what other priorities. Now, you know, I know that, you know, over the decade, you've switched, not switched, but you've added to your focus. And now a lot of it is around infrastructure and underwater infrastructure and the like. I'm much more familiar with the solar and the turbines and the like, but I'm very interested in hearing what you have learned over the past, 12 years as being water resource commissioner, in terms of what we can do around groundwater and green friendly infrastructure and the like, because that's a huge component of it as well.
No, sure. I mean, the way I see it is the federal government can be that backup for us to help us fund these things, help us develop national policies, but it's the local governments, counties, cities. Those are the ones that have the boots on the ground, that are the ones that are going to be out there doing these things. So we need a good collaborative relationship between all the levels of government to get this done. And I've been working on that through the state for a long time, and I look to go further. Hopefully you and I can, all the organs of the county government can work together coming in the next few years to really start funding these programs. So I look forward to that. We're running out of time. I just want to any last things you'd like to cover that we haven't really talked about before we leave?
You know, and again, Jim, I know you understand this and are probably more expert at it than I am, but I just don't think you can have a conversation around water quality and environmental sustainability without talking a little bit about environmental justice, because just like there are inequities in our criminal justice system, and there's inequities in our healthcare systems, and there's inequities in our educational systems, there are inequities in our environmental practices. And we do need to look at the things that we do. And I know we will be here in Oakland County through a lens of environmental justice in our efforts to bring equity to the county, to making sure that all of our communities, regardless of their wealth, have access to these programs, for instance, to make sure that drinking water or having access to high quality foods, or protecting our most vulnerable from health issues, mobility. You know, I'm a big transit fan. I think that plays into, you know, if we had a 21st century transit system in this county, it would be more environmentally sustainable, because we would make sure that those systems were that, but it would also provide this equity that I'm talking about. So, you know, just like every program in every area of Oakland County, we're going to start to look at through this lens of, is it equitable? Is it fair for all of our residents? Does it level the playing field from everybody? I don't just want our rich communities to have access to the environmental programs and infrastructure that they need. So we're going to have to make sure that we also look at these kinds of things through a lens of equity and environmental justice.
I could not agree more. We have to make sure we're pulling everyone along with us. We can't leave anybody behind, because that just causes trouble down the road, and it just can't be sustainable. So the triple bottom line, we have to protect our environment, make sure we have a good economy, and make sure we have social equity. And that is vitally important. I look forward to partnering with you on all these things. Thank you so much for being with us today. And I think we've run out of time. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Dave Coulter, our county executive. Thank you, Dave. The 2021 Kids Clean Water Calendars are free while supplies last. Over several hundred Oakland County 4th and 5th graders supply the beautiful art that we made our selections for. Congratulations to Save Water, Save Nature Covers grand prize winner, 4th grader Aditya Yogesh of Troy's Bernard Elementary School, and all the contestants. Info for ordering or the calendar library list is at WRC's website or our Facebook page.